Good afternoon. Today I'll be discussing my research entitled Social Work and the Inception of Religiously and Spiritually Competent Practice Within Institutions, the Role of Social Workers with Elderly in Hospice Care. Until recently, the role of religion and spirituality in the social work profession was rarely discussed. Yet a renewed interest in the relationship that religion and spirituality play within the social work field has led to a change in the processes through which social workers administer help to their clients' needs. With this in mind, implementation of such competent services may differ between agencies, leaving less room for social workers to include such a critical component into their practice. This study explored the variation in theories and practices attending to the religious spiritual beliefs, religious spiritual beliefs and practices of these EH clients. It also attempts to explore these issues, which may be present in determining whether or not clients are receiving religiously and spiritually competent guidance. To gain an understanding of how social workers can become religiously and spiritually competent in their practice, we must first identify parallels between religious and spiritual competence and culturally competent practice. Above you'll notice a few examples of current knowledge and research and practice literature. Particularly, the National Association for Social Workers has developed a set of guidelines for social workers to address this matter. The Standards for Cultural Competence in Social Work Practice elaborates the importance of addressing to the religious and spiritual beliefs and practices of clients when determining how to meet their needs. By applying this understanding of culturally competent practice in social work, professionals can begin to provide assistance with more sensitivity to our clients' religious and spiritual beliefs. Within hospice care, and particularly with the aged population, religion and spirituality sometimes play substantial roles in clients' lives. Religion and spirituality may provide support, offer meaning, and sometimes help to answer ultimate questions. Observing the elderly in hospice care allows for social workers to identify how clients' needs are met in a very distinct stage of life. However, due to lack of empirical data analysis of religious and spiritual competence in the social work field, there is a knowledge gap which needs further investigation, further research. It's essential that the aged in hospice care are able to reflect on these beliefs and engage in these practices throughout the entirety of their life. Social workers then are obligated to apply their knowledge in ways to help the elderly while still being respectful of the client's beliefs and traditions. This research is significant as it will provide a greater understanding of religiously and spiritually competent practice for the entire social work profession, and in return yield better outcomes for clients. It is believed that practicing religious and spiritual competence will help social workers more effectively serve clients, as it is a key component to human diversity. This research may help social workers to identify how people make meaning of life and death, and consider how religion and spirituality gives clients a sense of purpose for quality in the latter stages of life. This research study utilized an exploratory approach to investigate whether and how social workers serving the elderly in hospice care are practicing religious and spiritual competence. Using a convenience and snowball sample, I identified 19 social workers. I have interviewed 12 subjects at this point. 32 potential respondents were found through an online database, of which 17 agreed to participate, and 10 have already been interviewed. Two others were found as a result of referrals. Their clients are elderly persons who are at the age of 65 years or older and in the final stages of life receiving hospice care. By virtue of their profession and institutional affiliation, these professionals have been in close contact with the elderly and their families. I provided the respondents with a description of the research project and its implications for elderly clients. I assured them of complete confidentiality by promising not to disclose their particular identities and institutional affiliations. 8 of the 12 interviews were conducted in person, while 4 others were conducted via the telephone. The plan had been to ask each professional a series of 10 questions. It's important to note a limitation in the study's results that in 3 of the 12 interviews conducted, time constraints and length of responses did not allow for all questions to be asked and responded to. So each interview consisted of questions of a descriptive nature. Both were quantitative and qualitative, including respondent's age, number of years in the social work profession, and the number of years with the present institution. A description of those interviews are as follows. Numerically, out of the 12 social workers interviewed, 4 were men, 8 were women. 9 social workers were 50 years or older. 2 social workers were between the ages of 40 and 49 years old. And 1 social worker indicated to be between the ages of 30 and 39 years old. When asked how long he or she had been working with this population, 5 stated they had been working for 20 plus years. 6 had been working between 10 and 19 years, and 1 had been working between 1 and 9 years. The research also indicated that 9 respondents considered themselves to be religious or spiritual, yet only 3 elaborated and explained that their devotion to their beliefs by saying that he or she attends a place of worship, like church, every week, and or has a had a close relationship with a clergy member. When asked what religion or philosophical belief system he or she identified themselves with, 7 stated themselves to be Catholic, 4 stated to be non-denominational Christian, and 1 identified to be Jewish. Once this preliminary information was recorded, each interviewee responded to a series of qualitative questions. The questions that were asked are in sort of 2 separate categories that I've noted. First, there were questions which were more close-ended, easier for respondents to answer. For instance, the question of what religion or philosophical belief system do you identify yourself with was one with a smaller chance for respondents to answer with lengthy personal statements. Other questions included if you could ask any question of your clients related to religion or spirituality, what would it be and why? Or what questions would be most difficult for you to ask? And where do you find meaning in life? Each intended to be open-ended and allow for greater discussion, yet were more complex for social workers to answer, and in some cases presented a degree of discomfort in their responses. This research was exploratory in nature again, as it did not seek to test a hypothesis. I had chosen to use a grounded theory approach to analyzing my data. In this approach, researchers look for emergent themes and patterns. My intention is to gather and analyze more data as time allows, but I wish to offer some preliminary analysis. This research indicated some emerging themes. In 8 cases, respondents expressed a degree of discomfort when discussing religion and spirituality with their clients. 10 respondents indicated a lack of support within the workplace. This meaning a lack of information provided by the workplace to practice religious and spiritual competence. Examples are sort of like guidelines set for them. There was a lack of that or encouragement from other staff. And finally, 11 of the 12 interviewed indicated a lack of religious and spiritual competency training. One particular interview struck me to be the outlier of the group. The social worker that I'd interviewed worked with hospice institutions for 15 years and had to what he described an eye-opening experience just a few years prior with the client. The respondent, who I'll refer to as James, to maintain his confidentiality amongst the study, had become closer to one client than he had to any other client before. James first met with this client, as he stayed in the dismal day of November. He was sort of dramatic, but he was an interesting person. He continued to say, I recall walking to the front door anxious and exhausted from the week. As I gazed up at the darkening sky when one would normally feel a sense of discomfort or distress at such a dreary day, I had a surprising feeling of optimism rush over me. This was the day that I met Mr. Brown. James began to tell his story of his client, Mr. Brown, who had changed his life forever. as he stated it. Mr. Brown was 72 years old, and he was facing the last stages of his life. He had acted as a minister for a local church for 35 years. What was interesting about this interview, and particularly interesting in James' story, was the renewed sense of hope in life, which began to flourish from this one client he had met. They sat and discussed such ultimate questions as why are we all here, and what is true happiness in life. I asked James what had made him more comfortable with talking about religion, spirituality, with this particular client, as opposed to others that he has had in the past. And he indicated that because Mr. Brown was such a vibrant and open person, he was willing to share and discuss more with James than other clients had before. Without prompting him to, Mr. Brown seemed to feel more comfortable at his greatest ease when discussing ideas and philosophies of religion. Similarly, as discussed by James, he began to feel more comfortable talking about religion and spirituality, and therefore was more observant of his client's religious and spiritual beliefs from then on. James concluded by saying that undoubtedly, in this incident, it brought us to a level of understanding, and I hope for Mr. Brown a greater feeling of comfort in his last days. In this one case, it's important to note that James' relationship with his client, who was a minister, played a major part as to why James felt more comfortable about talking about religion and spirituality. As illustrated in the story told by James, social workers in hospice institutions can find that including religious and spiritually competent services within their practice, they can offer to the client a sense of purpose and meaning. This example had demonstrated how a social worker's interaction with the client as it relates to religion and spirituality can help to provide more thorough, competent assistance. In some ways, rather than formulating a conclusion of the data collected, I have alluded to results which need further research. It can be interpreted from the data of this research project thus far that the patterns which existed in the interviews were consistent. There were a number of social workers who were at a great discomfort providing religiously and spiritually competent services and expressed feelings of uneasiness. As explained by one social worker, she had felt her, quote, organization had not provided the social work staff with the proper support nor clarification of how to attend to the religious and spiritual needs of the clients, end quote. The National Association for Social Workers' Guidelines to Cultural Competency point to a continuing discussion about integrating religiously and spiritually competent educational services for social workers. Such services have yet to be offered at any of the 12 hospice care facilities discussed in this research. Each of the 12 hospice institutions also offer some sort of religion, some sort of religious or spiritual support in other forms. This includes like church services or access to clergy or spiritual members. Members of clergy in particular in each of these hospice facilities were more likely to adhere to the client's religious and spiritual needs than the social workers were. Due to this, social workers were less likely to ask questions about clients' religion or spirituality because there was simply someone else there to do it for them. Due to time constraints, I was unable to ask all the original questions I hoped to answer. I plan to continue conducting the 7 remaining interviews, following up on the 3 interviews which were cut short to finish answering any of the remaining questions. In terms of the future implications for research, it would be interesting to investigate further with additional questions for the professionals I had interviewed. Some of the questions I'd like to have answered are, would it be helpful for social workers to talk and develop a working relationship with members of the clergy and other professionals at their institutions? What would contribute a greater sense of ease when discussing religion and spirituality with the clients? And what now can you identify in your educational training as it relates to religious and spiritual competence that would be more helpful in providing assistance to your clients. In conclusion, and based upon my findings and analysis, I believe that what can and should be developed in these hospice facilities are interdisciplinary discussion, which would ultimately ensure the well-being of the age clients who are facing their end-of-life stage.